Good morning.
Good morning.
Come on up. Our opening hymn, Gene will lead us in number 43. Number 43.
Good morning. Welcome to East Livingstone Baptist Church. Today we are home to praise and give our glory to our God, who is the Father. So welcome to our visitors. And to begin with our service, I invite you to stand and sing together hymn number 43. This is my Father's world. So we're gonna sing all three verses. This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sing and on me sing music of the shine. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the throne of works and trees of sin and sin. This is my Father's world, the Bethlehem of song, the morning light, the earth is white, yet the maker's praise. This is my Father's world, he shines in all that's fair. In the world grows, I hear him pass, speak to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, oh let me never forget, that though the world seems all so strong, is the world I am. This is my Father's world, the water is not gone. Jesus who died shall not despise, heaven, heaven, one. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we came before you as you are our Lord and our Savior. We came here today to give you praise, to give you glory, because for everything you have done for us. So we know we disobey you sometimes. We know sometimes we don't do exactly what you ask us to do. Please, I ask you to forgive us. And please, continue to love us, because we are your creatures. You create us exactly as your image. So that's why we are here today. Please, Father, we ask you to speak to us today. We want to hear from you one more time, as you always do. You always be with us. And thank you for Jesus you sent to take the cross to save our sins. We ask you to bless our congregation and bless our time we're going to spend together today in your presence and in the presence of the Holy Spirit. This morning, we're going to put our voice together to praise how Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our sin as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's take a moment to greet one another.
every breath I breathe, and every song I sing, and every love I've ever known.
Good morning, everyone. Just a few announcements, and correct me if I'm wrong on any of them, please. Joseph's Coast donation for today. This coming Monday, the carpets are going to be cleaned on the first level, so if you have anything to do within in the church, Monday is not a good day. Bible study on Wednesday. Choir rehearsal, Saturday, 11 a.m. They keep getting that one wrong. 10 o'clock, choir rehearsal. church holiday decorating this Saturday. Everyone is invited to join. Come and decorate the church. You'll make it beautiful. We appreciate. And that's at 1 p.m. The outreach committee meets today immediately following the service. There's a deacon meeting Tuesday at 7 p.m. And I believe that's all the announcements we have for today. Thank you.
Our praise song is on page 427. I invite you to stand so we can sing together. Page 427, for He alone is worthy. Let's sing. Please stand and for He alone is worthy. For He alone is worthy. For He alone is worthy. Christ the Lord. We'll give Him all the glory. We'll give Him all the glory. We'll give Him all the glory. His Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ. Can we do number 3 one more time? Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Thank you. You may be sitting. It is time for our tithe and offering. Let me invite our usher to come. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for today and thank you for all the opportunities you give us. And thank you because we're gonna show how we appreciate, how we love you, where we're gonna participate in tithe and offering. This is a very small portion of what you gave us, so we're gonna give back because you know you have everything, but this little contribution is to make your word, make people know more about you, because there are people who still struggle, who doesn't know if you are the Savior, or who get confused. And then our contribution is going to go to these people to help our missionaries and us go to these peoples. We ask you this to bless our tithe and offering and bless those who are going to participate. And those who doesn't have, please give them something next time they will come and adore you with tithes and offering. Please accept our tithe and offerings and bless us in the name of Jesus. Amen. It is time for our junior church. And then now Pastor Cooper is going to take the lead in our service.
May we bow in prayer. Father, this is the Sunday after the holiday. It is the time when we say to you, thank you for the opportunity to go through what this past week has meant. For many of us, it has meant family and friends and feasting and a lot of fun. If there are those among us for whom that is not true, I do pray your consolation and your care for them. But you have allowed us to either to receive guests or to be a guest in another place, and to have the discussions that make us families and communities. We say thank you because we know that none of that gets formed unless you are the very center of its construction. You also have brought us back safely into a place of worship, and we are very grateful that you have done that as well. We recognize that around our community there are many who do not have the benefits of what we've just known. And I pray, Father, that you would do on their behalf what you have done for us. Allow us to become one. Allow them to become a part of that one. Allow them to have a source of trust. Be that source of trust for them. You have allowed us to know your leading. May others know your leading as well. Father, the very simple truth, despite the many complicated ways that we try to say it, the very simple truth is that you are the centerpiece of our being. And I ask, Father, that we may not only recognize it, but that we may live in that in a way that is intensely pleasing before you. Because ultimately, it's not about whether we get it and whether we enjoy. Ultimately, it is about whether you are lifted up and glorified and given that which is due to you. Again, thank you. And we continue by trusting you in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. I know it was dumb. I knew it at the time that I did it. But the truth is, you've done exactly the same thing in your own version, so don't feel smug. You may recognize this story just with your own details put in. During the time when I was in grade school, my dad worked away during the week. He was gone Sunday evening through Friday night, so that made Friday night really special when he'd get home and would be available to us for the rest of the weekend. It was always a wonderful time, and then he started to bring a little trinket here or there for my sister or for myself. And we enjoyed getting those, and then there was that day when I rushed out to meet Dad, and I said, "What did you bring me?" That was the dumb thing. Because I could see that it damaged a few things along the way. Okay, again, I suspect that you have stories that are very much like that. So did Jesus. Think about John chapter 11. We'll be working again in that passage this morning, so you may want to turn to John chapter 11. But as a review, there came a point when Jesus arrived in Bethany at the risk of his life, having known that there were very powerful people around who wanted to get rid of his life. He arrived just in time to hear the two sisters who were dear friends of his say one after the other as they're greeting to him, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now, there's a certain politeness of that, and there's a certain kick in the shins with that. And you can recognize both parts. I can imagine Jesus just kind of going off in a corner somewhere and sitting down and just kind of thinking through and trying to overcome what had just happened to him at the hands of very dear friends who didn't mean to hurt him any more than I meant to hurt my dad. What is fascinating about the story, I think, is beautiful. and that is that despite being treated in that way, Jesus engaged his family and his friends just as though they hadn't messed up like that. Truth is that he wept alongside them, and in that process, he revealed that he had anger as well as a hurt because Lazarus wasn't there with them to share the moment, of course. He was angry. Remember that word? Furious, as though he was a volcano that could have blown. He was very angry, not at Mary or Martha, but at the enemy, and at the way that the enemy had used death as a way of just beating on the people that God loved. In John chapter 11, the gospel goes a little bit deeper than the story that I have told you. I told it to you that way because routinely, whenever we hear a story, what we immediately try to do is to make it about ourselves, and we think in terms of my reaction to. So hopefully I have started the story in the way that any person who hears any story would react. How can I turn this so that it becomes about me? But it isn't. And the deeper part of John's chapter 11 is that Jesus keeps the emphasis in the right way. You have perhaps already turned to chapter 11. I ask your attention would go to with me to verse 33, and we'll read 8 verses along the way here. When Jesus saw her, that would be Mary, weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. That's the anger. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." So they're understanding only a very small part of why it is that Jesus is crying. But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But, Lord," said Mary, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. And then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. There's a lot more in what I have just shared with you than I think you've probably just naturally bring into the story. There is, for example, that line that says, "Take away the stone." We'll get to that in just a moment. But for Jesus to get to that point in the story, he has to say a couple of other things that allow the stone to be even considered for moving. Can you imagine you say, "Take away the stone"? You have everyone looking at you at this point, regardless of whether they like you or not. You are the center point of their attention. Martha had said earlier, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died, but even now I know that God will give you what you ask of him." There's a confidence in that, And I'd love to say the amen right alongside of you, but I don't think I can in this particular case. Because I think what's going on here is that Martha was just using the language of a crisis to try to be encouraging to herself and to Jesus. And most of what she says is empty, unfortunately. So this time she challenges him. You kind of wonder, Jesus, have you lost it? You have to be, if you're Martha, you really have to be asking that kind of a question. So what Jesus gets is a pressured obedience, not actually true belief with the idea that, well, Martha just knew this was going to happen. At this point in the story, I need to tell you something about those extra 2 days that Jesus waited back where he was isolated from the people who wanted to kill him. You remember they sent a message from Bethany to him saying, the one you love is sick, and he accepts the message, and then he just stays, inexplicably, just stays there for 2 more days. We did the math, and so we know that those 2 days would not have meant that if he had just gone immediately, he could have gotten to Lazarus in time to save him. But what is it that's going on in the story? The what's there is actually something that happens in Hebrew understanding, Hebrew tradition, but not in the scriptures. What's going on there is simply the Hebrews believed that when a person died, they knew that physical deterioration began. And that's the reason that even to this day, Hebrews do the very best they can to ensure that a person is buried the same day that the person passes away. I think it's a question of not allowing the deterioration to mean a shame for the person who has died. But they also believe that when you die, your spirit hangs around just in case it's invited back in. And again, this is not biblical, but they believed it. The idea was that for 3 days, that spirit will be there. And then after 3 days, either the spirit gets tired of just hanging around or is yanked by God to another place. In either event, the person is assumed to have their spirit gone, and there's no question about whether the person has died. So by putting those extra 2 days in the process, Jesus has assured himself that everyone who is going to see this happen, this being the resurrection of Lazarus, everyone will know absolutely he is dead. There is no question whatsoever. He's dead. Now, I watched the game yesterday, and I really felt I had to do something to get Scarlet and Gray into this slide set. So that's how I arranged it. He talks at first, did I not tell you such and such? And the basic idea that's there is simply, I've already given you the information, Martha. He's speaking again to Martha. There is no place in Scripture that I know of where we learn when he had told her the first time. Probably it happened during that conversation when Martha went out to see him and did her little splurt and started things, and it's just a part that wasn't put in because we'll get it here. So let me read that verse and see if I can mess it up, see if I can get it for you. Did I not tell you that if you believe the glory of God? Now, why did I handle that in that particular way? obviously I'm able to read the word S-E-E as see. The reason I did that goes back to something I have mentioned to you on multiple occasions before. And that is simply that if you see a word that is repeated a good bit in a short passage, maybe only two or three times, then pay attention to it, because there's something important in the word itself. Now, that word S-E-E is actually used in the Gospel of John 74 different times. So there is a little nugget of information that's tucked into those three letters. Of the 74 times that we see the word in the NIV, the original had five different words. And every one of those words has a nuance of one kind or another. In this particular instance, the word that John selected out of those five possibilities to communicate this, it does mean to notice something, to physically view something, but it goes beyond that. It goes to the point, well, let me say it this way. If you really understand the meaning of something, we say, oh, I see. And that's what's going on there. It was a word that was used by John at a different point in the gospel, out in the mouth of Jesus, when Jesus was talking about what he had seen in the presence of his Father. And the basic idea there was that Jesus had been with his Father, had been able to view something with his Father, and then perceive the spiritual meaning behind what it was that his Father was revealing. So that idea of being able to perceive the spiritual meaning behind something is what's in that verse. Now, let me do one of the little tricks that I hope you are learning from me, and that is when you have a definition, you plug it back into the sentence and see how it works, and see if it helps you to understand what it means. So I'm going to read that same verse again, but I'm going to plug the definition into it. Martha, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will perceive spiritually, you will understand why Lazarus had to die and why I took the two extra days and how this all involves the glory of God? Now, if that is the accurate meaning, which I think it is, I haven't tried to mislead you in any way. If that's the accurate meaning, then it has some real punch to it. And it probably would be a part of the reason that a woman who is concerned that her brother has deteriorated and is stinking, that promise would be enough to leverage her to say, okay, let's do it. And, you know, gather a few people around, and together they moved the stone. We don't know who that is, but it's they rather than just Martha who had done that herself. This is a little rabbit trail, and I want to share it with you, and then we'll go back to the main part of the story. The little rabbit trail is very simply this. You noticed the statement that there's a bad odor connected with a deteriorating physical body. Now, the reason that has meaning to me and will become important in a story that is very close to this one, that follows it very soon, is that probably means that they either did not use any anointment to prevent the stinking, or if they used relatively little and it got overpowered after 4 days. what you have then is the story of Mary and Martha, who do not use at least much perfume and ointment for their brother's death, but Mary very soon will break off the top of a bottle of very expensive perfume and apply it to Jesus. So they are doing for Jesus what they had not done for their brother, and it makes it a very special event when we get to that part of the story. Let me read verses 41 and 42, and then we'll talk about this rather unusual prayer that Jesus offers. Then, and I ought to set the background, because I selected a slide that I think does it. If you can imagine that Jesus is standing in front of this crowd of people, however many there are, and we aren't told if it's a big group or a little group. We just know there were Jews from Jerusalem there and the family, and there could have been more than the named family. And Jesus has already said, move the stone, and that's been done. You know, when you have done that, you become the center of attention. Whatever else is going on, you become the center of attention. At the very critical moment that's right here, Jesus is very careful to give glory to his heavenly Father. He doesn't take it for himself. I mean, he's going to raise a dead man. And so he says, pay attention to my Father. Don't pay attention to me. If it was if it was presented differently somehow, I'm sure that we'd all see it as a violation of who Jesus is. Because constantly throughout this story, he has been saying, my Father says, you're not paying attention to me now, you're paying attention to my Father. So this is entirely consistent with who Jesus has revealed himself to be. I can imagine himself standing at the focal point of attention and doing what Jewish people would do, raising his hands, and people would recognize that's how we pray. And so it's very possible that the other people around him, as in this story, would have raised their hands as well, expecting probably one of the memorized prayers that are so common within the Jewish faith. And he says, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. That's absolutely critical along the way. So let me ask you a very simple question. You ever pray like that? I want us to notice the parts of it. Nothing has changed at this point in the story. You have a dead man in a grave. You have the mourners. You have the stone moved away, so it's pregnant with anticipation. But nothing has changed. And he says, Father, I thank you for hearing me. Do you ever pray like that? Before the meaning comes, you say, thank you. I want to have you leave your finger right in this passage, because we'll immediately come back. But let me take you into the last chapter of 1 John, a sermon that John wrote probably after this gospel. And there are some expectations that are being restated in 1 John chapter 5, starting in verse 14, and it is John writing, this is the confidence that we have in approaching God. Now, if this has anything to do with John chapter 11, the subject is confidence. This is the confidence we have in approaching God. That if we ask anything according to His will, critical variable, according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we have asked of Him. I propose to you that this form of prayer is one that requires a lot more faith than we normally put into our prayers. It is therefore a form of prayer that is much more pleasing to the one that we want to receive our prayer. And it is very apropos to ask, have you ever done this? Have you ever known others who do this? Who say, thank you, nothing has happened yet, thank you. It is a statement beforehand, I trust you. And that's a big part of what prayer ought to be communicating. Now, I want to take us down to verse 45 and verse 46 in a moment. Because in a way, Jesus, in what He has just said and what is going to happen in the next couple of moments, has become an evangelist of sorts. When it's all said and done in verse 45, therefore many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in Him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. It was a dirty trick. You have Jesus having convinced some to believe. In this particular instance, that idea of believe has to mean, I am convinced that the Father has sent this Son. I mean, given that the definition of believed is really in the verse, I think it's appropriate for us to be alert to that, to the fact that it's there. But there's this other group of people who have seen the same resurrection of Lazarus from the dead. And they are so stuck in what I'm choosing to call a residual sin, a residual missing of God's mark. They're so stuck in what they brought into the situation and what they were believing beforehand, that even a resurrection from the dead is not going to pull them away from that idea that death is final. And so what they do is they make a report to the Pharisees. You've heard of those guys? The Pharisees were the very people who had been threatening Jesus, and everybody knew it. And the report that they make is actually the final trigger that causes the plot that means Jesus will end up on a cross, dying in agony. They are the people who made it happen. And of course, in the group of people watching this, in his disciples, is one Judas Iscariot, who now has a motivation to go out and do exactly the same thing. And I wonder if perhaps you're seeing the thing that caused him to actually pull the trigger and make the betrayal of Jesus actually occur. These are people who are betraying the very man who has just raised their best friend from the dead. I mean, I can't say enough ugly about that. But people are not rational. We make a mistake if we try to assume that people are rational. Because the truth is that sin blinds people, and sin binds people, and you're seeing an example of, yeah, I got to talk to Lazarus, and I'm going to do in the guy that made it possible. Well, going back to the spot where we get to experience together the end of the story, the beautiful end of this part of the story. Verse 43 and 44 are the parts that we've left out. When he had said this, Lazarus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" Do you think it had the same effect? I mean, he didn't have a microphone, so that I didn't scare the guys back there, but do you think it had that same effect? The dead man came out, his hands and his feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Same basic idea as happened with Jesus just a week or so later. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." So let's work on making that ours. Can you imagine that you are either Mary or Martha? Pick one, it doesn't really matter in this particular instance. Imagine that you are one of them and Jesus says that Lazarus come forth. And you're right where the picture suggests you would be. And everybody is looking at you, and I wonder, are you feeling a little bit foolish? I mean, everybody knows the man's dead in there. And you're staring in at a dead guy. And firmly dead guy. I don't know how long it took, but even if it was that fast, I bet that for those two ladies, this was the longest period that they could remember. I mean, it's just one of those where time seems to drag really slowly. If you're one of them, what do you expect is going to happen in the next few minutes? I mean, remember, the guy in the middle, he let this happen. You gave him a note, you sent him a message, and after all, being God, shouldn't he have been able to anticipate it anyway without the message? And he let their brother die. So now do you trust him in this kind of an awkward circumstance? And then, I don't care which one of them you assign this part to, but that must have been pretty much the way things looked from Lazarus's viewpoint, those two sisters. And then finally, one of them, did you see something? I think he moved. I think he moved. He's sitting up. Oh. And after that, you don't have words anymore. Because what you've got are two sisters rushing up to this brother and smothering him in the way that you would do if it was you. And they're so caught in the moment that Jesus has to say, did either one of you happen to notice the man is still wrapped in grave clothes? He can't barely move. Maybe you ought to do something to make him a little bit comfortable. And so that's how the story concludes. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Let me take you to another story. I remember a man who told me about being 20 years old in 1935, he went to his dentist because he had a tooth that needed to be extracted. He sat down in the chair and was administered laughing gas. I guess that's still done, but obviously today there are technologies to ensure that what happened with this guy doesn't ever happen again. And the laughing gas killed him. Temporarily, He tells the story of the tunnel and the light at the end that's absolutely consistent. I've read a number of different accounts of near-death experience, and that's absolutely in line with all of those accounts. He tells the story of going through that tunnel. And when he got there, he was greeted by a number of people. People who had died that he knew. And so he knew them and they knew him, and it was a wonderful reunion. And there was this one lady that obviously knew him, but he had no idea who she was. And he kind of liked it there, wherever it was that he was. But they started to say to him, sorry, you have to go back. Something, you're needed back on Earth. And so he did, in fact, go back and rejoin just his body in the dentist's chair. Sometime later, by the way, he found a picture of the lady that he did not know. And the people he was visiting at the time said, yes, that was so-and-so, and she died shortly after you were born. She knew him, even though he had no way of remembering that he knew her. Well, that man was my father. And if he hadn't come back, you'd have somebody else standing here. That whole process of, you know, moving in, like as Lazarus must have done, moving into another time and then coming back, imagine what that would have been. Do you think that Lazarus would have wanted to come back to be with Martha and Mary? Do you think that Lazarus would trust his decaying body? I mean, after all, on one occasion it had let him die. I think those are serious questions. Most everybody that I, when I have done this reading, most everyone who has had one of these experiences says, I just don't want to go back to Earth. That's not preferable to me at all. But I want you to remember, some weeks ago, we looked together at the healing of the man born blind. And you remember in that story that there was a time when Jesus picked up some dirt from the ground and he spit on it, and it would be gross if it wasn't Jesus. He, having made mud, he put that mud on the man's eyes, and we said, boy, that's really the same basic stuff as is going on in the early part of Genesis when God used mud to create people. So what Jesus is doing in that story in John chapter 9 is not just fixing something. He is literally recreating the man's eyes. So he has quite a set of options that he can do. And when Lazarus does come out of the grave clothes, one of the things that happens to him is he's able to function. He's able to eat. He is able to be the guest of honor at the feast where Mary eventually will anoint him with that pure nard and give Jesus the honor that accompanies that. So Lazarus is recreated in a way that will work for whatever period of time he remained alive on this earth. Now, obviously, he knows in time he's going to have to go back to wherever it was that he was temporarily. I think it's very tempting to emphasize the kind of points that I've just emphasized, to have us think together about them. But I want you to be very careful. The Gospel of John uses the terminology of signs as though it's not simply something that Jesus does, but it's something something that Jesus does that points at primarily at who this man is and who Jesus is. And I prefer to lead you in thinking about who this man is. John chapter 11 displays Jesus' total control over death, over deterioration and how to reverse it if you want, Jesus' total control over a forever future. He has the capacity to overcome whatever it is that's going on in the background. He just runs the process. And the truth is that Jesus will provide for all believers by recreating. And all of a sudden, what you have is not simply that this story, isn't it nice that Lazarus was able to walk out of the grave? But that's a little part. What's really there is, isn't it nice that you and I, any believer, is able to walk out of the grave? If you were born in the 1930s and 1940s, you may have been around when Dizzy Dean said, "It ain't bragging if you can do it." And he could do it. Jesus raised Lazarus so that everybody could perceive spiritually, could see and perceive the spiritual impact of that particular event. This is the director of death. He overrides even the one who makes death happen. It's normal in any of the Gospels, and especially in John, for Jesus to reveal what is ahead. An awful lot of what happens in the Gospel of John, Jesus says, and he must have confused the daylights out of everybody around him, because he was talking about stuff that hasn't happened yet, and they had no real way of getting it, and he got a lot of enemies. He built up a lot of anger toward him and people leaving as a result of doing that. Even in chapter 3, you remember that Jesus says to Nicodemus, there's going to come a time when the Son of Man is put up on a stick, like the snake that Moses held up in the wilderness. I mean, he had that telling ahead of what nobody could understand what was going on, but he said it then, and a little bit later, John, who had would have been there listening to this conversation, could go, oh, he was talking about this all the way back there. What you're seeing is that Jesus in John 11, in the raising of Lazarus, is modeling what the value of his going to the cross will actually be. He's going to become the doorway for the sheep. He is going to give wide-scale life, eternal life, to masses of people, to millions of people who will follow Lazarus and the pathway that Lazarus traveled. And see, what you're seeing is not just Lazarus's pathway. It's yours. And you have some loved ones who are believers. I can't say this if the loved one is not a believer. But if you have loved ones who are believers, then you get to travel the same path. Actually, the truth is that every person will live through their death, and there will be many who think they're dead, and they will come back to life, and then there will be the judgment, and they will have results they don't want. But this is something that's very special. This is a reunion. This is giving to a person the capacity to laugh with friends and have fun with them and to do all of the things that that sharing life together means. This is an awkward picture, but it's nonetheless, it's the best one that I could find on the subject. Those are coffins, and there's guys who are coming out. And you understand, I hope, why the story and the picture go along together. John 11 is the pre-explanation of the why behind the death of Jesus and the why behind his resurrection. And he gives that before he dies, does anything, before people know what's going on. It's frustrating to say that there are always some people who will disregard this story and the story that follows it about the resurrection of Jesus. Residual sin is always going to be an issue, isn't it? It hits the people that you love as well as the people that you've never met. When you return to life, do you think you'll have the outcome that's worth returning to life for? I want to ask that very seriously, because if you are in Christ, then the answer is yes. If you are not in Christ, then the answer is no. And it does break down that simply. I want you to imagine that you're one of these people. And the word comes, put in your name here, Pastor Al, come forth. And you come out of wherever you were placed at death. Can you imagine that? And the reconnection that happens when that becomes a reality? Well, that's the promise. A promise that becomes absolutely trustworthy on the basis of a man who dies for you and then comes back to life himself and shows that he is, in fact, everything that this story made it appear that he is. I've asked Karen, and she may have spoken to some of the other deacons this morning, simply to be available. Because if you have to talk to someone about decisions that you have made with reference to the decision of who Jesus is and whether I will believe in him or whether I will discard him and walk away from him, have that conversation now and don't regret it at some later time. So when we're finished, I don't know if it'll be in the middle of the final hymn or whenever it is, at some point, Karen will just be available at the front of the church. And if you'd like to talk about that, then find her. And make sure that you settle that issue. Because it would be absolutely frustrating to everybody in the story if you didn't get something that is this clear. Make sure that you have Jesus Christ in your heart. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for saying that in that love is stuff like this. The raising of a man who is me and any other believer, and then the raising of the one who is standing behind me and these other believers, to say it's all going to work exactly as he said. And I just ask, Father, that you'd help every one of us to ensure that we are on the correct side of this story, that we're not some of those people who had their best friend raised from the dead and missed it. We trust you with getting it right. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. The final hymn, okay. Our final hymn is one that was written by Fanny Crosby. I looked around, I discovered that Fanny Crosby, of course, lived to be a very old lady, and she was very much involved in helping people, helping the down and out especially. One of the reasons for that, by the way, I suspect, is it seems to have been triggered by the fact that at one point she was married. She was almost 40 when she was married, and very soon they had a child, and that child lived very briefly and then died. And in some ways, she spent the rest of her life trying to make sure that other people didn't suffer in the same way. And so what she does is she offers this hymn so that we really understand that there's an invitation that is involved in the process. So I'm going to ask you, I was hunting for my bulletin, I don't have that, so you have the number in your bulletin. I'm asking you to turn to that hymn. We'll stand together, we'll sing the first two and the last verse of that hymn. Jesus is tenderly calling me home, calling today, calling today. Why from the sunshine of love wilt thou roam, farther and farther away? Calling today, Jesus is calling, tenderly calling today. Jesus is calling the weary to rest, calling today, bring him thy burden and love shall be blessed. He will not turn thee away. Calling today, calling today, Jesus is calling, tenderly calling today.
Verse 4.
Is pleading, oh, list to his voice. Hear him today, hear him today. Though believe on his name shall be joyous, quickly usher and away. Calling today, Jesus is calling, tenderly calling to.
Well, the deacons are over on the side where the piano is. If you'd like to talk with them, they're available for that purpose. What we have seen together today is that God spells out the story before anyone needs to know exactly why it's happening. He tells you what's behind it, and he demonstrates the power. And I invite you to ensure that you are included in that magnificent story. Amen.